And today's speaker is Alexey Rodenko with a talk about intersections of Brownian motion on Carnot group. Please.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
And can you see my screen?
Okay.
Okay. So the name of the talk, multiple intersections and potential for several independent Brownian motions in Carnot group. So what I was planning to do today is to show you some results for about multiple intersection of independent Brownian motions in Carnot groups. So the plan of the talk will be as follows. I will formulate some questions that I had about this topic that motivated me to look here, and then I will discuss in detail one paper by Fitzsimmons and Salisbury, 1989, which contains some results very relevant to this. And in the end, I will show you how these results of this paper gives me some theorems that relevant to this topic. And well, basically, there will be a little new from some perspective, yes, but from the other perspective, this is the results that I wanted to get. So it is also very relevant. So it turns out that I can rely on this paper to do something new. So I will discuss this paper in detail. I hope it will be interesting, okay? So the problems that I'm considering are as follows. Suppose we have independent stochastic process. Of course, this can be just Markov process, a function of Markov processes. In my case, functions of Brownian motions and Carnot groups. And the question, the original question was to find the conditions necessary and sufficient so that we have intersection with positive probability. And we also can introduce some set and say we have intersection on this set, but this is not relevant now. What's important is this is a part of more general question. So suppose we have this such process, this already can be called multi-parameter process, yes. And for this process, we can also ask whether it visits a set or not with positive probability. And this is a more general question than the previous one, yes, because of in the previous one, we have very specific V, and here we have general V. So this is more general question. And in fact, here I can also already assume that each Xi are Brownian motion in Carnot group, because it to also include cases when I consider functions of them. So it is a general question that I need to solve. And I had a paper that gave a condition for this probability to be zero. This condition was in terms of some asymptotics, of some surface measure. But the problem was that that condition was not working in some known cases. So there were cases for which I knew that probability is zero, but the condition wasn't working. And in these cases, I only could prove that the number of intersection points are finite. So this also kind of made me to ask related question, and whether the number of points, the number of intersection points are finite or not. So it is also interesting to look for the probability that the number of intersection points are finite. Of points of time such that we visit. Well, originally it was points of space, but if we have different points of time and we have a process that doesn't intersect, that we also have points in space, different points in space. But again, it doesn't matter now.
Can I have a question?
Yes.
My question is following. At least in case of two-dimensional Brownian motion, we know that the set of these points where we have self-intersection if it is infinite, has a very complicated structure. Near one point, we have a lot of another points of self-intersection. So maybe we can expect the same complexity of the structure of the set of points of intersection, or a more general set as you present. And we can expect to study something like Hausdorff dimension and so on.
Well, what I wanted to say with regard to this is that, yes, of course, I expect that a finite number of points is basically impossible. It's either zero or infinite. And the reason is this thing. Yeah, so I think that this should happen with probability one. Yeah, so with probability one, if we fix if even we fix t, right, and we fix t, and if we start, if we take probability that we start from some point of v, then generally speaking, it should be one. In some points, it might be zero, but the number of points where it's zero is small, so they're not visited by the points where it's zero. So this is regularity. This is actually another question, but I decided not to show it, but yes, it is another question about regularity, and it is maybe possible to show that, like in usual one parameter case, that regular points have capacity zero, so non-regular points have capacity zero. So this will show that yes, it has complicated structure. So each time we visit a set, we visit it again infinite number of times in some small period of time. So
okay, thank you.
It is my conjecture. For now, I cannot formulate theorem, but I think in using the results of this paper that I will show you that maybe it is very, very real to do it. So
okay.
I hope I can do it. And yeah, of course, this is also I included here infinity because it reminds me of a Wiener test, right? So it is actually for one fun parameter process we have Wiener test, and actually we can have similar Wiener tests for multi-parameter process. But I've seen only one paper where it was done, and it was by the same author as the paper that I'll be presenting, but it was done for random walks, so I will not speak about it. But it is interesting because their methods might work and for processes too. So hopefully, again, this also can be done. Yeah, and the paper that I will be considering is again Fitzsimmons-Salisbury capacity and energy for multiparameter Markov processes. And well, just the short a few words what we're going to see. There will be a multiparameter Markov process which will have trajectory which consists of joint trajectories of several independent Markov processes. And then there will be a definition of capacity for such process. Well, you can say that there will be different definitions, but there will be equivalent. And then it was shown in the paper. And it was also shown that the probability to hit a set, the one that I was looking at, is can be bounded above and below with constant multiplied by capacity. Of course, there are some things that I'm not telling you right now about what kind of probability, yeah, because it is very important, but you will see later. So, I also have to say that there are two other works which basically on the same topic and have also the similar results. I decided to focus on the earliest work, mostly because in the other papers, the situation is more general. So it will be it just harder to explain what was done there. So the ideas of this original paper I also liked more. So I decided just to talk about the first one. But also in the paper of Hirschsong, in fact, there is not just one paper. They had a series of papers on this topic they define that multi-parameter Markov process slightly differently, but as partial case, they had also several independent Markov processes as in the previous paper. And they also had some of independent Levy processes taken in different moments of time. They could consider such process, multi-parameter Stein-Uhlenbeck process and so something else. They had more general case. And they also did basically the same, introduced capacity, some other notions. They also considered abstract potentials theory with regard to corresponding potential, yes. And they also defined multi-parameter additive functional. Also in the previous paper, they also considered multi-parameter additive functional. In fact, they are very important for them, but I will also talk about this later. And the last paper that had the same results is a book of Hoshnevisan, Multiparameter Processes. Also, he had a paper together with Shi on the same topic, but for Brownian sheet, I believe, for specific case of Brownian sheet. But it is in this paper, in this book, he considered a general theory of multiparameter martingales, multiparameter random walks, multiparameter Markov process. Again, with slightly different definition, I believe, but in some partial cases, it's the same. And he also developed some abstract potential theory, and then he proved basically the same result, slightly different in form, that the probability to hit a set is bounded above and below with capacity multiplied by cost. So this is the main three papers that have this kind of results, and I will talk about the first one. So to do that, I will need some additional definition. So suppose we have a family of symmetric standard Markov processes. Well, in fact, authors of these papers, they claim that maybe they have at least some of the results is not just for symmetric processes, but for more general special standards that have dual special standard process. But as some of the results is specifically for symmetric, so I just decided to say symmetric. And yeah, I also write RD, but they consider more general metric spaces. Doesn't matter. And MI, if the process is not symmetric, then the corresponding measure should be just excessive measure. We can use it. And also we have semigroups and corresponding resolvents, since defined. And we should suppose that Xi are transient. Well, again, because we need the density of U0, resolvent at zero. And this, if this is true, then at least we know this defined for some XY, right? And then we can define potential, yes, for several independent processes as multiple of potential for each process. This is the definition of corresponding potential for potential density, maybe for the multi-parameter process, and this so-called energy that corresponds to the measure mu with regard to this potential defined as follows. And in terms of this energy, we can define capacity. One of the definitions of capacity, well, it is not capacity, but 1/capacity, but it is, the idea is just so that it measures how big is the set in a sense, right? So regarding to this potential. So we take infinum of all energies of all measures such that they are concentrated on the set and have total mass of 1. And then we also can define these probabilities to hit a set. And this is very special definition because, as you can see in the next slide, this and this will be related. And this is why we need this special definition. We define probability to hit a set starting from some measure. And this measure is also not necessarily finite, maybe sigma finite, but it is important that this holds, right? So, and we take supremum over such probabilities. And this this quantity is the probability, okay, one of the version of probability to hit a set that the authors were considering.
So when we have a starting measure just sigma finite, this symbol p nu is the integral of probability that we start from some point and hit the set, and then integrate it over the measure nu. Am I right?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, thank you.
And so the main result of Fitzsimmons and Salisbury is the following theorem, that in fact these two quantities are related as follows. And in fact, constants are very specific to power n or something. I just don't write them down. They're very specific, depend only on n. This is the result. Okay, and I also need a different version of this result because it is easier to deal with. So here you see this is slightly complicated. We have supremum and some of these conditions not trivial to maybe in some cases. So there is another version of this result which uses different gamma b, but to define it, I need to define a so-called Kuznetsov measure. So what is this? Suppose we have a standard Markov process and excessive measure, then it is known that suppose we have it is known that we can define some measure on the space of paths that goes from minus infinity to plus infinity, and so that they start at symmetry, then they write the path is right continuous, and then we end at the symmetry. So well, it is possible that alpha and beta are just infinity, minus infinity and plus infinity, but in theory it is possible they are not. So this of course relates to whether we have equality here or not, I think. And yeah, of course we define corresponding sigma algebra and name the corresponding process that T. And then it is it was done in by Kuznetsov in 1994. It is known that there exists a unique sigma finite measure on the space of paths such that basically at each point the probability, not the probability, but this is the distribution of just one dimensional, that T. Right, and then if we have several, then we starting from T1, we use semi-Hilbert of our process. So it kind of as process started from this measure.
And M is fixed for, M is the same for all T1.
Yes, yes, and it is called sometimes stationary process related to Markov process, stationary Markov process, something like that.
I see. And the problem that M may be infinite?
Yes, it may be sigma infinite, sigma finite only, yes.
Yeah, and you have to start from symmetry to symmetry. Yes.
Yes, and sometimes because it is not necessary equality here, we may have that we may kill some trajectories to make this correct. Yeah, and then if we reverse time, we also have to start from not always start from minus infinity.
So PT, is it a semigroup? Just is it probability semigroup or
no? I think not necessarily, but even if it is, the problem is not the problem that we might not have this equality anyway. So I think maybe even if it's probability, it might not be that. But actually, I'm not sure. It is, yeah. From what I saw in the paper of Kuznetsov, I think
I think that the only one problem is that we have a locally finite n, a locally finite stuff. So we have to be very accurate in constructing because we just are playing with locally finite measures at any time t. And we know that it is not not too trivial to construct the measure on the space of function.
Yeah, yeah. In the paper of Kuznetsov, he just makes it a sum of finite measures, and then he, for each finite measure, he just specifies specifies exactly what is the distribution,
okay.
And then use Kolmogorov theorem. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
This is basically the idea of the proof.
Mm-hmm. So the sigma finite is the same, more or less the same for any time, for any time. Okay.
Yeah, and of course, the only problem is this alpha beta. We have to take care mm-hmm. of the fact that we can be in the symmetry, but it can be done. So so such measure exists, and what does it give us? It helps us with defining.
Let's say, into what are assumptions? Could you please
again? It's a standard Markov process, maybe even not standard, just Markov process.
Mm-hmm. And you have, and is M the same here and in Kuznetsov theorem? So you assume that you have a standard Markov process, and you have some sigma finite measure which is excessive.
Yes, I think if we take Brownian motion and Lebesgue measure, then we have equality and we have alpha beta minus infinity and plus infinity.
Yes,
I think
it is essential that we have excessivity property.
No. There is measure control. M in a theorem.
Yes, the same measure.
The same, but
yes, it's basically the same because I told you that it was if the process is symmetric, it is a reference measure for and then it will be excessive, and otherwise, it just we have to take excessive measure.
Okay, I thanks.
Think. Okay, let's go further.
Yeah. And okay, another interesting trick. So we're going to use to this measure to kind of take expectations of the idea of the authors is we can use this measure to define function also with regard to as a function with regard to this measure and calculate the kind of expectation. And it turns out that it's easier to do if we for the, with this construction than when we start from the point. But the problem is that if we take a simple functional integral minus infinity plus infinity f x t dt, then q from this is infinite, typically. And instead of q, we have to define measure p. Measure p, well, I'm not sure if I can explain it, but it is kind of... Well, this is the equality that basically that defines its measure. P defined not in all sigma algebra, but in the sigma algebra of all invariant sets. So we have all sets that invariant with respect to shift, and then on all the sets we can define such measure by this equality, and it defines this measure. And in the paper of this Fitzsimmons, it was studied and it was shown that yes, such measure exists and satisfies these properties. So that we can take a kind of expectation of the additive functional and obtain something meaningful. Another definition of the P is that P from A is Q from A if some time belongs to 0, 1. Where S is any homogeneous time. Homogeneous time is this. Yeah. this definition. It is strange, it looks strange, but in fact, it turns out that it doesn't matter which homogeneous time we use, it will be the same, and it defines this measure also.
Can I ask you a question about this definition? Because it looks that this sigma field of invariant sets is not very rich. For example, if we work with the two-sided Wiener process, yes, then what we know then. Actually, we have some constants, so this says like constants, yeah. What?
No, we can have some functions. Look here. So this is a typical representative of this
of such function. Yeah?
Yes, yes, yes. So if we, for example, take this as a function from XT, yeah, so this will be a representative then, right? So this can be a representative of such set of random variable measurable with regard to this sigma algebra.
I just tried to imagine such a function with non-trivial integral for two-sided Wiener process.
Yes, I think it is interesting construction. For me, it's not very obvious. I don't know. I'm maybe not explaining it very well because I don't understand it very well. But
for example, if we have just one dimensional Wiener process, the reference measure is a Lebesgue measure. And from one side, we have that F, for example, if we take F, which is indicator of ball of radius one and the center at zero, then the right hand side is finite, but the integral is equal to infinity for one dimension. Yes.
No. If you take here for one dimensional Brownian motion.
Yes.
Of course.
The integral
you
is
see, I mentioned this, but the process has to be transient.
Oh, yes.
Yes. It is very important. You're absolutely right.
Okay. So what we have, we just move along the trajectory, all picture along trajectories of our process. Yes, and then please can you show us again the definition of this strange probability? Very interesting. Okay, so we have such sigma t. Sigma t is just a uniform time. So this is a random time, which is also stationary connected with all picture.
So sigma t is just a shift of time.
Yes.
T capital, yes?
Yeah, T capital is a homogeneous time. And to define homogeneous time, in fact, they prove that such times exist. And in fact, they can take TK such that converges to alpha. It is very important for the construction that you can construct such homogeneous time. And this is possible because we can consider again such kind of things and from them construct such times.
So, for example, such a homogeneous time, what it can be in case of two-sided three-dimensional Wiener process, it is transient. It is in some sense stationary with respect to Lebesgue start. And then, what can be a homogeneous example of homogeneous time?
Yes, example of homogeneous time. I think you take T, R infinum, such T that integral from minus infinity T F is T. Say greater than some positive.
Reach some level, yeah.
Something like this.
Reach some level. Then we just shift trajectory and we get what we get the shift. We have to wait. Okay, yes. Okay, and then we have such a definition of P this random variable. Okay, and for such random variables, it looks like we have the shift in those with respect to this Kuznetsov measure. This shift now saves this measure, and we have some stationary variables, and this measure P is defined on the like invariant variables with respect to shift. Yes, okay, and so if we have a classical situation when this measure is finite, then we have a classical ergodic like ergodic theory. We have invariant measure invariants sigma field with respect to all shifts, and we can consider the functions, and we have some invariant measure on this functions. Now because of we have actually sigma finite measure, so we want to define the measure on the just on the invariant sets, and and we just so this F with tilde is just representative. Just representative of the variable measure with respect to U, but they claim maybe that it is enough to define P on these representatives. Yes,
maybe I'm not sure. Maybe I should write this as definition. But I think I read that this is enough, but maybe I was wrong. I don't know. I'm sure that this is enough because it defines
okay,
it.
Okay. Yes, but this is much more complicated because of presence this homogeneous time.
Yeah, but it is proved that this follows from this. So it's
yes, surely, surely.
Yes.
And let me ask at least for this page last question: P will be a probability or not? Maybe not.
I don't know. I don't know.
Maybe not, because, for example, from the line where P of this integral is equal to integral F over M, we can find that, for example, if F or what, or maybe we can.
I don't know. I looked at several papers about this, and none of them mentions that it is a probability measure. So it is very unlikely.
Yes. Okay. Let's take F as indicator of set which is which grows to all space. Then, because of it, it is. Oh, no. Okay. Yes. So it is not clear. Yeah.
Yeah, I do not know.
Okay, it is not.
I can't tell you.
So we have just a new measure, and it is defined on the invariant sigma field with respect to the shift related to the dynamics on the Kuznetsov space. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So why do we need such construction? Because it turns out that if we define this. This is, of course, belongs to this sigma algebra of invariant sets. So we can define P from this, and we obtain again probability of hitting a set. And it turns out that it exactly the same that I defined before. It was proved by Fitzsimmons and Salisbury. Somehow it turns out to be the same.
If it is the same, why we need a so complicated construction?
Because now, if for example, we know that that's a zero versus P, we also know that it's zero versus Q.
Versus Q. Mm-hmm.
And Q is very specific. And then we know that for starting from measure M, we hit the set with probability zero.
Mm-hmm.
It allows us to, at least with respect to zero sets, P and Q are the same. So
okay.
We can work with respect to Q also in some cases. And this is what actually I can use, I think.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So yes, and so the theorem that I showed before, which was true for this probability, also true for this probability.
Mm-hmm.
So and now I want to tell you something else about which related to the proof of this theorem, which is about homogeneous additive functionals. Or as they call it, homogeneous random measures. It is not a full definition because here I have something that I do not define in the end, but still I think it is interesting because first of all, such functional was introduced by Dimkin in 1991. I don't know if he was the first, but Fitzsimmons and Salisbury reference his paper a lot. And I think the construction relies on some of the parts of the construction of Dimkin. What is homogeneous random measure? It is a kernel, so it is a measure on one variable, very measurable function, another variable. And we have that, so that its support belongs to this, to where our process lives. And also, well, it is not infinite, so it is finite on some function f, so it is not infinite. This is also the technical condition. And then, it is invariant versus shift in this sense. And the final one is basically, well, I think in Dinkin, the equivalent would be that K from I will be measurable with sigma algebra, which is, I did not stop here, but the construction of Q was done for the one dimension, one parameter process. But if we take, product of these measures for different for independent processes, then we obtain Q for several independent processes, and it's just the same basic. So here we have several processes. So EI now is a rectangle, generally speaking. So not just interval. So in Dinkin, I believe he has such conditions that if we take this from rectangle, then this has to be measurable over the sigma algebra generated by the process in this rectangle. Here, instead, Fitzsimmons Salisbury has this condition. They say that suppose that that this homogeneous random measure has to satisfy that if we take optional projection from it, then it is the same. But what is optional projections? I do not want to give all the details, but basically for each process, we can define optional sigma algebra, and then we can define projection on this optional sigma algebra for both for additional functionals and for just for any measurable process. We can define this optional projection. And then what happens is that this, for this random measure, optional projection is the same as the measure itself. So basically measure itself is optionally measurable in a sense. This is the condition. So basically, this is the condition, the measurability condition, which is for some reason they do it like this. And then how do they prove their theorem? The main part of the theorem is to prove that if we have If the set is actually, this probability is not zero, right? So then we can construct such function. This is their idea. And if we can construct such functional, then we can relate it to the energy. So the relation to the energy is, I will write it down. I will show you later. But right now, how do they, just a few words, how they construct this function? First of all, they construct such time t, which is homogeneous, and such that that t belongs to this set which we have to visit. They construct such time. And then they take k. I'm sorry, I have something with my mouse. Just a second. Okay, it works. Okay, so they take functional k from a is one if t belongs to a and zero otherwise. So they define this such simple additive function and such simple random measure. And it will satisfy everything except the last condition. And then for the last condition, then just take this optional projection and co-predictable projection for each coordinate. And they prove that they commute. And so the end result will be so that we have this condition after we take this projection. And after they take this optional projection, they obtain some additive functional or homogeneous random measure which satisfies all their conditions. And they also mention that what they obtain is basically intersection local time in some sense.
Okay, so the main trick maybe and main difficulty is the construction of those homogeneous random time.
Yes, this is the main point that they mm-hmm. are somehow able to construct it using optional projection. Just from this simple definition, from they take some random time. Of course, there is no moment of heating. Yes, but we can select such time that this is time, kind of a time of heating, but not quite. It is not measurable in a meaningful way. But then after they take optional projections, they can make it measurable somehow.
But it looks like if such a homogeneous time exists, it is exactly the same that we have those desired properties that we visit this V, yes?
No, but the problem here is if we suppose we start from zero, right? What is the first time when we hit, we have two parameters, T1 and T2, right? So our time runs in two directions. So there are points, could be several points when we hit our set, here. Which one do we choose? This is a problem.
I am just speaking not about the problem of measurability. I understand that it is a problem, but before to make this optional projections, I think we have to guarantee that this homogeneous time exists.
Yes, of course. Yes.
And existence of this homogeneous time, in some sense, equivalent to our desired property that we have this PM with index M from the event that we sometime we visit this V is greater than zero.
Yeah, but okay, we assume that it is greater than zero, and then
do estimation in from one side, yeah.
Yes, it is only one side estimate. Yes, the other side is much simpler. I just don't consider.
So the other side maybe is standard. Yes,
it is very simple because if you see here in the definition. It is another definition of this of the capacity using just homogeneous random measure, and the trick here is just the other side. I believe is just simple inequality that if we have k square that hits v, then we can say that this is greater than equal by k that hits v squared divided by probability Z hits V, something like that. This type of inequality. This is just.
Yes, I remember that we can use just strong Markov property and potential, yeah? And then we have the estimation using capacity.
So this is that gives us one side estimation, and then this order that remains is to estimate to relate this to the energy, and this is this is why it is simple. This is why we needed all this construction, because now if we take this reviews measure. Can call it differently, but they call it reviews measure for this for this homogeneous random measure defined like this. Then turns out that the energy is related to the not expectation but measure from K square, P from K square. So this is the main reason why we needed this construction to have this relation. And 2 power n is because we have 2 power n the directions from zero to go to infinity, different different directions of time. Somehow it works like that, I don't know. Okay. And this is it. So this is all about this paper, I believe. So they have these results, and now let me try to say something new using these results. So suppose I have Brownian motion in Kronov group, and usual definitions, I skip them, so I need this vector fields corresponding, this is Brownian motion, I also can have corresponding degrees and distances on each GY. And also just to mention that it's possible to prove that this is symmetric standard Markov process. So, and the measure is the back measure. So this is not a problem. So all this construction can be done for this case too. And also we have estimate for the transition density using this book. In this book, it is shown that we can estimate from above and below with exponent from the square of distance and multiplied by t power q divided by 2, where q is homogeneous dimension of for each g. And then we have also estimate for the potential like this. So it is something that I already told before, but basically the potential have this form, you can say, right, for each process. Then using the results of Fitzsimmons-Salisbury, I can prove the following two theorems. First of all, if this energy is infinite for any measure, then the probability to hit starting from any point, the probability to hit set is zero. I assume that the set is bounded just because I need I write here not just general potential but this rho power to minus q, because general potential is different. It's only the same in the balance. And then again, if this energy is finite for some measure mu, then for each x the probability is positive. And how to prove this theorem? I use the version with measure p, p bold, right? The one that I constructed. And if I have, if this, for example, if this holds, if the energy is finite, then I can prove that p bold is greater than zero, which means this q also greater than zero from that event. But that means that if we start from measure m, from Lebesgue measure, right? If we start from Lebesgue measure, then the process does not hit this. So integral over Lebesgue measure of this is greater than zero.
Excuse me, can I ask you about the this first statement? So you say that if for some non-trivial measure with support...
If for any.
Oh, if for any we have.
Yes, it is
But,
just that the energy is infinite, the energy defined
but
before.
let me say what happens if I take the measure concentrated in two points. Yes, for example, or discrete measure at all, discrete measure, then what we will have,
Well, this
we will
function blow
have
up of the
infinity
diagonal,
because
so
this blow up at the
yeah, go up
diagonal,
in the
yeah?
diagonal.
Okay, I see. Okay, thank you.
Of course, I have that QE is greater than equal than three, so
Yes,
that the process is
yes,
transient.
I remember it blows up at
Yeah.
the diagonal. Yeah. Okay.
I can using this, I can have this result almost everywhere. But using Markov property, I can do it everywhere because if we have some set, if we have some point in which we think it is zero, we can just use Markov property for all processes and then start from some positive time t. But at this point t, our distribution will be something which is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. So the integral will be positive. And it means that for any point we have positive. And the same works here, except we need similarly, we need to consider to say that for all points is zero, we have to consider points, suppose some point is not zero, then we again spend some time, and small time, and then after this time, it has to be zero, yes, because integral Lebesgue measure is zero. And then we take this time to zero, and it means that this probability zero for all x. So I believe it just works like this, and it is basically a simple consequence of results of Fitzsimmons in Salisbury. So that we can have these conditions for existence of intersections for Brownian motion of Carnot loop. And this is it. There is some of the references that I used, but thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much. Maybe somebody have comments or questions, please.
So, do I understand correct? If you have time, just regular one-dimensional, then you have classical results on heating sets. You have to find capacities and so on and so forth. And now the problem is that the process is multi, the time has many dimensions, so you have to describe analog of these capacities and
yes,
so-called and some theory which is analogous to construction of Markov processes. That's why you
yes.
need these Kuznetsov measures. For example, maybe for usual Markov processes you have some entrance laws or something like this, and then you have general result that if about this in double integrals with respect to m, with respect to mu, and estimates of you have nice estimates of transition probability density functions, and then you just apply. Yes, so you
yes,
have,
it is.
So general theory is well known, but now you have to apply in concrete situation.
Yes, well, I actually knew that it kind of possible, but I was looking mostly only on this paper, and here the condition is the result is slightly different. He used Martingale's theory instead of this Kuznetsov measures, basically instead, because he has to use something, and I didn't have that. So when I looked in this paper, it turns out that if we use Kuznetsov measures, then maybe I can have such result.
Oh, and I have one more question. So you talked about optional projection and so on and so forth. But now the time is multidimensional. So what does optional.
I said only one coordinate. So we fix one coordinate and we take optional projection on one coordinate.
For
then
each
same
coordinate.
As for the second and so on. Yes. Mm-hmm. For each coordinate separately. Yes.
Thanks.
And we also have to kind of reverse time and do the same. So it seems something like this.
Okay, other questions, please.
I have a short question about the estimate of the density.
Yes.
Exactly. So this basis for the Carnot group, these functions are smooth.
Which functions?
The corresponding vector fields that you used to define the process.
Yes, vector fields are smooth, yes.
So there is also some estimates for the density of the diffusion process by Struk and Kusooka.
Yes, there is a paper, Kusooka Struk, which also yes, you're right. This is another reference for a similar estimate, you're absolutely right. But I use this one because it is, for me, it's just more convenient, but they also have some things, other things that they needed. So.
Thank you very much. They are related. Thank you.
Yes, you're right. This is Kutoka Struk, I believe, also had, they used Malevin calculus for similar estimates. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much for interesting talk. So for today, this is all. And Georgi, who is the next speaker? Georgi.
Next speaker is Viktor Yusupovich.
Okay, then see you next week. Bye.